Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Empires of the Week, the real story of European expansion and the creation of the New World, by J.C. Sharman, narrated by John Lee. Preface and Acknowledgments. One of the great pleasures of writing this book has been the opportunity to roam around considering historical questions that are fundamental to how we think about politics past, present, and future. The really big changes in international politics have little to do with the European major coalition wars that are often the staple of international relations textbooks and scholarship. These wars have basically upheld the status quo of a fragmented Europe with a slowly changing cast of great powers. Great by parochial European standards, if not always by more cosmopolitan global ones. So when it comes to transformations of international politics, perhaps it would be true to say that nothing interesting has happened in Europe for at least the last 500 years, perhaps even since the fall of the Roman Empire. For the shifts that have fundamentally altered international politics, we have to look elsewhere. Prominent amongst these transformations is first the creation of a global international system and the accompanying multi-civilizational order. Second, the briefer but vitally important period of European imperial world dominance for around 100 years or so. And finally, the even shorter span that saw decolonization and the return of Asian great powers. I am mainly concerned with the first of these topics, the creation of the first global international system. Dating roughly from the end of the 15th century to the end of the 18th century, this centers on a process of European expansion that helped to knit together previously separate regional systems. It is important not to read European expansion as synonymous with European conquest or empire. Instead, in Africa and Asia, the process of expansion owed much more to European submission than dominance, particularly when they encountered Eastern empires far mightier than any European great power of the day. Europeans had little choice but to pay deference. Though they were quick to use violence whenever they thought they could get away with it, more important than military prowess in explaining expansion was the coincidence whereby Europeans' goals were largely maritime, trade routes and port outposts, whereas local great powers were concerned with controlling land and territory, but largely indifferent to the seas. These complementary preferences allowed for a rough and ready coexistence. In addition, European ventures in the East and the Atlantic world were crucially reliant on the cultivation of local allies, patrons and vassals. Finally, in the Americas, various pandemics allowed European adventurers to destroy local empires, though these well-known triumphs were balanced by lesser-known defeats. In the early modern period, right through to the present, changes in military and political institutions across civilizations proceeded according to cultural prompts, largely independent of functional concerns about effectiveness and efficiency. In making and backing these claims, relating to a huge range of times and places, this book either had to be very long or quite short. The reason for writing a short book is the hope of appealing to a somewhat wider audience, inside and outside of academia, that might not usually be much interested in history, and perhaps a few people who might not ordinarily read social science. But if there are benefits to a short book for both the author and the readers, it's only fair to acknowledge that there are serious costs as well. The main penalty is the lack of room to really dig into and discuss all the brilliant work relevant to the topic that has informed my thinking. In getting feedback from various generous colleagues and three anonymous reviewers, a recurrent theme was that there are so many other authors, theories, and debates that could and should receive more attention in the text. These commentators are right. There are many authors, theories, and debates that could and should have received more attention, or even a mention, but by and large, they haven't. It's very important to stress that this is not a sign of disrespect or disagreement with either the original authors or those providing comments, nor is it an effort to overstate the originality of this book by slighting the work I build on. Instead, it reflects a calculation that research, writing, and many other things are based on trade-offs, and that the cost of neglecting vast reams of earlier scholarship is nevertheless justified in having a shorter and more accessible book. Although this book is less concerned with immersing the reader in existing scholarship, it is in part an attempt to gently nudge, rather than hector us, to think a bit harder about how Eurocentric we still are, and what this costs us. No doubt all right-minded, good-thinking people already agree that Eurocentrism in the abstract is a bad thing. But to see how much the problem is still with us, one only has to look at the table of contents or indexes of most books on international politics and history to see the extraordinary predominance of European places, actors, and events relative to the rest of the world. This book has some of the same bias, but I hope to a lesser degree. If I have flagrantly disregarded much of the wise advice I received about including a more detailed literature review, it remains true that many of the key elements of my argument here I owe to those who were kind enough to comment on draft text or oral presentations. I was particularly lucky to begin the project at one very stimulating and supportive academic environment, Griffith University, and finish it at a very similar institution, Cambridge University. I thus had two sets of colleagues to exploit. At the early stages in Brisbane, Sarah Percy, and especially Ian Hall, gave me crucial steers on what was wrong with my first cut at the project and, even better, how I might go about fixing it. I presented initial versions at Griffith, the Australian National University, and a little later at my current departmental home, Politics and International Studies in Cambridge, and the European International Studies Association. Some of these meetings have featured formal discussants who went well above and beyond their rather thankless mandate in working hard to understand and improve my rough drafts. And so thanks in particular to Daniel Nexon, Sean Fleming, and Alex Weisinger. Similarly selfless was the commitment of the three anonymous reviewers of the draft manuscript. It was a privilege to have my ideas receive such careful and constructive treatment. Andrew Phillips taught me a lot about how to do this kind of research in various discussions over the years, some directly related to this book, others tangentially. At Cambridge, the department and the History and International Relations Group, organized by Maja Spanu and Orr Rosenboim, has provided the perfect setting for bringing this research to completion. In Cambridge and in London, Aisha Zarokol, Duncan Bell, and George Lawson further helped me think through some big historical international relations questions. I am also very grateful to David Runciman for providing the first link with Princeton University Press. At the press, Sarah Caro performed an invaluable role in shepherding the manuscript through to acceptance and completion. Though this research is very different from my other interest in tax havens, money laundering, and corruption, the common thread is that any research takes time, and getting time often requires money. The Australian Research Council has been extremely generous in providing this money through grants FT120100485 and DP170101395. Some similar arguments appearing in this book were first featured in the article Myths of Military Revolution, European Expansion and Eurocentrism, published in the European Journal of International Relations. In some ways, the book marks a return to an even more ambitious, failed project I tried almost 40 years ago, History of the World, SICK. With any luck, having completed a primary, secondary school and university education since that time will make for a somewhat more successful result second time around. Speaking of the longer term, as ever, my biggest thanks go to my family and Biljana. Introduction. The Military Revolution and the First International System. European expansion from the end of the 15th century to the end of the 18th transformed the world in creating the first genuinely global political and economic systems. It was initiated by near simultaneous voyages west across the Atlantic to the Americas and south and east around the coast of Africa, across the Indian Ocean to Asia, by explorers like Christopher Columbus and Vasco da Gama. The subsequent growth of the European presence across the oceans is often said to be the result of superior military power, better weapons, and better organizations for using them. Known as the Military Revolution thesis, it argues that expansion was primarily the result of European militaries and states outcompeting opponents abroad, because Europeans were better adapted to the demands of war, having survived and learned from fierce competition at home. It is based on the assumption that competition produces more efficient organizations that are better adapted to their environment, thanks to a combination of rational learning and Darwinian selection. In this book, I question each element of this account and suggest an alternative explanation. Europeans did not enjoy any significant military superiority vis-à-vis non-Western opponents in the early modern era, even in Europe. Expansion was as much a story of European deference and subordination as one of dominance. Rather than state armies or navies, the vanguards of expansion were small bands of adventurers or chartered companies who relied on the cultivation of local allies. Fundamental to the European success and survival was a maritime strategy that avoided challenging the land-based priorities of local polities, and in the Americas, disease that brought about a demographic catastrophe. The greatest conquerors and empire builders of the early modern era were in fact Asian empires, from the Ottomans in the Near East to the Mughals in South Asia and the Ming and Manchu Qing in China. Giving due attention to these great powers helps to correct the Eurocentrism that has so often biased earlier studies and brings into question conventional cause and effect stories about war making and state making. A more cosmopolitan perspective reveals the diversity of the relationships between military and political development, in that there were many roads to different outcomes, rather than one route to a common destination. This alternative perspective contrasts with the traditional view of European expansion being a state-directed effort, premised on using the same tactics and technology as in warfare between Europeans. It brings into question the idea of tight cause and effect connections between new weapons, tactics, large standing armies, and the rise of the sovereign state. More broadly, the argument put forward here contradicts and supplants the model of military competition producing efficient, well-adapted fighting organizations through some combination of learning and elimination. The significance of the process by which the first global international system was created is in many ways obvious. Vast, ancient, and previously isolated civilizations came into regular contact with the rest of the world. People, goods, diseases, and ideas circumnavigated the globe for the first time, transforming societies and ecologies in their wake. Yet for the purposes of this book, I concentrate on a few key implications for world politics, but also for the way we study it. We have had a connected global international system for around 500 years, a period often seen as synonymous with the era of Western dominance. The assumptions that have underpinned the study of the international system and the theories developed to explain it both start from this premise of Western military and political hegemony. But in fact, for more than half the time there has been a global international system, it was not dominated by the West. On the contrary, European nations were puny in comparison with Asian great powers like the Mughal or Chinese Ming and Qing empires in terms of population, riches, and military might. The fact that this has often not been recognized illustrates how deeply warped our sense of the historical development of international politics is, and has huge implications for our understanding of the past, present, and future. Biases of place and time have not only systematically overstated the importance of European powers while understating the importance of those from other regions, they have also fixed a single deterministic path of military institutional development as constituting the historical norm. The history of warfare is crucial as the raw material for generating and testing many social science theories. Military force has been regarded as the ultimate decider in world politics, The military revolution thesis that recurring wars between the great powers drove military innovation and state building in Europe, which subsequently gave these states a competitive advantage they used to dominate non-European polities, is a bedrock of much historically oriented social science. It has informed our understandings of the rise of the sovereign state and the modern state system. Scholars are increasingly interested in the rise and fall of the international orders. The period from 1500 to the end of the 18th century gives us an example that is at once intimately connected to our own through myriad historical legacies, while being distinct enough to jolt us into an appreciation of how a pluralistic global order works, absent the domination of any one civilization. How much of what we think we know about the way international politics works is really a parochial, Eurocentric perspective on the way Western international politics works? The early modern period uniquely has a potential to answer this question. From the conventional historical perspective of a Columbian or Vasco da Gama epoch of military-driven European dominance, the prospect of a global international system not dominated by the West, sparked by concerns about rising powers like Japan, or more recently, China and India, looks historically unprecedented, a leap into the unknown. Putting early modern Asian great powers in their proper context would make such a future world seem much less remarkable or strange. Perhaps it would be a return to the historical norm after a relatively brief period of imbalance. This is one way that changing our views about the past can fundamentally change our views of the present and the future. In looking at the way history informs our theories of how international politics works across time, I offer some thoughts on the relationship between the disciplines of history and social science. A key conclusion is that historians and social scientists share more similarities than either often likes to think. I also emphasize what those in the social sciences, especially international relations and political science, can learn from recent revisionist historians' work about relations between Europeans and other civilizations in Africa, Asia, and the Americas to supplant the military revolution thesis. Any effort to understand a topic as huge as the creation and workings of the early modern global international order requires the insights of different disciplines. The shape of the argument. A recent book observes that in all the debate, few scholars have actually tested the claim that the military revolution underlay European colonialism. To what extent did Europe's military innovations between 1450 and 1700 actually provide Europeans an edge in warfare? The evidence I present in chapters 1 through 3 shows that the military revolution thesis simply does not fit with the evidence from either Spanish conquests in the New World or Portuguese, Dutch, and English engagements in Asia and Africa. To begin with, the styles of warfare Europeans used abroad were almost completely different from those that they used at home. With rare exceptions, neither the tactics, nor the armies, nor the organizations fit the templates of the military revolution thesis and great power war in Europe. The volley fire by massed musketeers protected by pikemen that came to dominate warfare in Western and Central Europe was almost never used elsewhere. Instead of the massive armies states deployed in Europe, expansion in the wider world was propelled by tiny expeditionary forces. Furthermore, in most cases, these forces were essentially private, being ad hoc bands of adventurers or chartered company sovereigns. Different circumstances in different locations called for different responses, undermining the idea that there was one superior European way of war. More fundamentally, by and large, there was no general European military superiority over other civilizations in this period. The conquistadors achieved their most famous victories in the Americas thanks to a combination of disease, local allies, and cold steel, while their less well-known defeats belie the myth of their invincibility. Europeans maintained their toeholds in Africa under the sufferance of African rulers. On the rare occasions the Portuguese and others challenged African polities to war before 1800, they generally lost. Europeans adopted a general position of deference and subordination to the manifestly more powerful empires of Asia, from Persia to the Mughals to China and Japan. Once again, the Portuguese, Dutch, English, and Russians were all on the receiving end of sharp defeats in the exceptional instances they clashed with these empires. Finally, at home in Europe and the Mediterranean, Europeans struggled to hold out against the Ottomans and experienced consistent disappointment in their military ventures in North Africa. So far, this is all rather negative. If not the military revolution, what then does explain the first few centuries of European expansion? It's important to spell out the main elements of my positive thesis. First, a reminder that expansion is not at all the same thing as domination or conquest. In early modern Africa and Asia, the European presence was overwhelmingly maritime, focusing on militarized control of seaborne trade through key ports and sea lanes. In contrast, most powerful local polities were largely indifferent to the seas, being concerned with control of land and people. This coincidence of complementary maritime and terrestrial preferences allowed for a rough coexistence between the lords of the land and masters of water. Despite a general European posture of deference to more powerful local rulers, certainly it was not all peace and harmony. Expansion involved a great deal of violence. At a more tactical level, European coercion of weaker African and Asian actors rested on the cultivation of local allies and military, logistical, political, and cultural adaptations to varying local contexts. Finally, in the Americas, as noted, there was the additional factor of disease and demography that laid low the most powerful empires and consistently sapped the strength of indigenous resistance thereafter. Taking a less Eurocentric, more wide-ranging view of the interaction of wars, politics, and society from the western to the eastern extremity of Asia further undermines key tenets of the conventional wisdom. The Chinese, who invented and developed gunpowder weapons from 900 to 1200, had already reached most of the key milestones of military and administrative modernity centuries before Europeans. The Ottomans and Mughals constructed polities that commanded far more people, money, and military power than any of their 16th and 17th century European counterparts. The Mughals overawed the essentially trivial European presence on the fringes of their domain until the unraveling of their empire at the beginning of the 1700s. The Ottomans steamrolled their opponents, first by destroying the last remnants of the Roman Empire, then conquering Arabia, North Africa, and Southeast Europe. How does an understanding of these Asian polities change our perspective on developments in Europe? First, it disconfirms the idea of a single path to military effectiveness, of sequences of necessary and sufficient causes, either technological or tactical, by which war makes states. Second, it undermines stereotypes according to which relatively transient successes by small European polities are too often portrayed as epochal triumphs, whereas mighty, long-lived Asian empires are characterized as merely failures waiting to happen. The discussion so far may seem to be avoiding the obvious retort. The Europeans won in the end. In response, the concluding chapter examines the lessons drawn from the early modern period in light of the subsequent experiences of the 19th century new imperialism, when European armies carried almost all before them. It then contrasts the new imperialism with the subsequent European contraction in the 20th century, characterized by decolonization and Western defeats at the hands of various communist and Islamist insurgencies. It makes the point that the Europeans didn't win in the end. Their empires fell and their military capacity shriveled. Even the United States has experienced more defeats than victories against non-Western forces over the last half century. I argue that the broad contours of events from the end of the early modern period to the present tend to bear out the primacy of ideas, legitimacy, and culture over explanations based on rational efficiency and selection, and also cast doubt on the idea that technology and battlefield predominance are the mainstays of military effectiveness and geopolitical success. 19th century empires were often, essentially, prestige projects that did little to advance the military or economic power of the European nations in question. The struggle over decolonization saw technologically and administratively more advanced societies and militaries consistently lose to less advanced ones. European powers won most of the battles while losing most of the wars, a pattern that recurred in the US counterinsurgency wars of the late 20th and early 21st centuries. This brings into question the importance of technology and the presumption that military adaptation leads to more homogeneous organizations rather than more differentiated ones, as part of the now familiar idea of asymmetrical warfare. I expand on each of these more general points and the relationship between history and the social sciences in the second half of this introduction. But the priority now is to lay out what the military revolution is and how it is said to explain the European expansion. What is the military revolution? Several of the key ideas that provide the foundation for the military revolution thesis, especially the decisive role of gunpowder weapons and military competition in Europe, have been in circulation for centuries. They are found in the writings of Montesquieu, Gibbon, Mill, Burke, Adam Smith, and Schumpeter, among others. Yet in its contemporary form, this argument was first put forward by the military historian Michael Roberts in 1955. Roberts saw the military revolution as sharply dividing the medieval from the modern world, thanks to an interlinked process of rapid military and political change in Europe 1550 through 1650. It is worth noting that for international relations scholars, the Treaty of Westphalia that concluded the 30 Years' War in 1648 conventionally marks the beginning of the modern era. There are four key elements to Roberts's argument: tactics, strategy, army size, and state development. Tactical change came about from the 1590s, when Dutch reformers adapted classical Roman linear battlefield formations and began drilling musketeers in volley fire. A few decades later, the Swedish king Gustavus Adolphus combined this innovation with light field artillery and the reintroduction of the cavalry charge. Mastering these new tactics required more training, especially extensive drill, and more officers, in turn necessitating a permanent, salaried, and professional standing army. The coalition warfare of the 30 Years' War in Central Europe saw an expansion in strategic aims, as multiple armies were used to achieve military objectives. The third change was that armies became much bigger, the result of a revolution in strategy made possible by the revolution in tactics, and made necessary by the circumstances of the 30 Years' War. Both the total number of troops rulers maintained under arms expanded, as well as the number committed to individual battles. Finally, and most importantly, larger, professional, permanent armies required much more money to pay for them. Rulers had to develop a centralized, hierarchical, administrative apparatus and reach deeper into society to extract the necessary resources. Here was the crucial link between changes in warfare and the development of the modern state. In his brilliant essay, Warmaking and State-Making as Organized Crime, Charles Tilly explains the process as follows. After 1400, the European pursuit of larger, more permanent, and more costly varieties of military organization did, in fact, drive spectacular increases in princely budgets, taxes, and staffs. After 1500 or so, princes who managed to create the costly varieties of military organization were indeed able to conquer new chunks of territory. Thus, success was said to bring about a self-reinforcing positive feedback loop. Greater resources generated greater military power, which then generated yet more resources. Each of these elements was said to require the others in the same set causal sequence, rather than being changes that just happened to coincide with each other. The engine that drove this whole process was said to be military competition. Those that failed to keep up were beaten and perhaps eliminated altogether. This idea of Darwinian military competition spurring military innovation, learning, emulation, and elimination is a recurring theme in both historical and social science scholarship, and is covered in detail at the end of this introduction. The Military Revolution and the Rise of the West. Roberts's argument was influential, but was only indirectly related to developments beyond Europe. The next step, taken by Geoffrey Parker, was to link advances in European warfare to the rise of the West more generally. As a result, the Military Revolution thesis is now more significant for discussions of the rise of the West and developments outside Europe than those inside Europe. Parker began by modifying Roberts's original thesis, emphasizing guns and fortifications rather than tactics as the original source of change. Specifically, in the 1400s, new cannons were able to batter down medieval castle walls. Suddenly vulnerable, rulers scrambled for a solution entailing a new style of fortifications with low, thick, artillery-resistant walls, coupled with angled bastions which caught attackers in intersecting fields of fire. The catch, however, was that these new traces italiennes, Italian-designed fortresses, were very expensive to build and required a large and correspondingly costly army to garrison or attack. Thus, by a different route, Parker got to the same point of intersection between war and state-building as Roberts. More money and more troops required the development of a centralized administrative apparatus. Once again, military competition was the engine of change. Rulers learned that to remain competitive in war, they had to keep up with these new trends. Those that did not risked being conquered and disappearing from the scene. For both Roberts and Parker, the pressure to centralize and extend the state apparatus was paralleled by the tendency whereby smaller feudal lords and private wielders of violence fell behind the demands of the military revolution, and so were progressively absorbed into the new fiscal military states. Undoubtedly, the most important innovation of Parker's argument, however, was in the direct link between the changes in the character of European war and the subsequent European expansion in the Americas, Africa, and Asia. The pressures of military competition within Europe were said to have produced organizations with superior military effectiveness relative to those in the rest of the world. Parker summarizes his thesis as follows. The key to the Westerners' success in creating the first truly global empires between 1500 and 1750 depended upon precisely those improvements in the ability to wage war which have been termed the military revolution. A crucial link between the European and global aspects of the military revolution thesis is the accompanying advances in naval warfare. New dedicated warships capitalized on more advanced navigation and design techniques to venture further, while carrying rows of cannon able to sink ships and bombard targets ashore. Like new-style fortifications, these gun-armed ships were very expensive, reinforcing the pressures for more tax revenue and intrusive state intervention in society in order to stay competitive. The feudal and private groups that had carried on medieval naval warfare were unequal to these demands, and hence were sidelined. The Western advantage in military technology and organization relative to other civilizations was said to pay off quite early. By 1650, the West had already achieved military mastery in four separate areas: Central and Northeast America, Siberia, some coastal areas of sub-Saharan Africa, and in some parts of the Indonesian and Philippine archipelagos. According to Parker, the combination of new weapons, like muskets and artillery, new tactics, new warships that were able to cross oceans and dominate naval and littoral areas once they arrived, and finally, the financial, logistical, and administrative wherewithal of the newly centralized modern sovereign state enabled Europeans to bring around a third of the world's land area under their control by 1750. While some historians have queried the timing, duration, and revolutionary character of the changes identified, the thesis has won broad acceptance as an explanation of European expansion, in part because it builds on and complements a much older and established tradition of thought. The idea continues to enjoy wide currency that, from around 1500, Europe began to dominate other civilizations due to superior military technology and techniques developed thanks to especially intense security competition within Europe. To be sure, there are important variations. Some believe that Europeans' military edge was itself a product of an underlying institutional and economic advantage, which once again reflects the uniquely competitive nature of the European international system. Others point to favorable geography or cultural attributes as preceding or producing European military superiority. Others see the particular type of military competition in Western Europe as especially conducive to stimulating innovation. For example, as one of the few areas of the world not threatened by horse nomads, Western Europeans concentrated on improving early guns that were useful in infantry battles, but not for countering cavalry armies. Those working in the field of international relations have tended to take on the same logic. Following Thompson's military superiority thesis, MacDonald summarizes the dominant state of thinking in the discipline on why Europe conquered much of the rest of the world by exactly replicating the military revolution argument. European warfare underwent a profound transformation beginning in the 16th century. On land, the spread of gunpowder-based weapons, as well as specialized fortifications designed to resist these arms, transformed the nature of combat. European states were increasingly compelled to raise large standing armies, which were dominated by highly trained and well-drilled infantry. Although driven by competition between European states, the unintended consequence of this military revolution was to widen the gap in military power between Europe and the rest of the world. Even social scientists who explained the eventual dominance of Europe as being due to economics often still employ the military revolution thesis as a vital part of their account. Thus, the economist Douglas North asks, "What set off the expansion of Western Europe, which led to its ultimate hegemony in the world?" Approximate part of the explanation, though certainly not a complete one, is the revolution in military technology that occurred in the late Middle Ages. The crossbow, the longbow, the pike, and gunpowder had implications for the organization and capital costs of warfare. The costs of warfare rose. So, accordingly, rose the costs of survival of political units. Because kings were supposed to live on their own, they were faced with devising ways to increase fiscal revenues. Those approaching the question from a Marxist perspective also use the logic of military competition to argue the link between deep economic causes and geopolitical outcomes. In late medieval and early modern Europe, there was little possibility for a single empire or state to subdue the entire continent. This lent itself to a more unstable and fluid geopolitical environment in which military competition and war were a near constant feature of European life over many centuries. The rapid growth in Europe's military sectors was perhaps a key reason, along with the development of stronger fiscal and organizational capacities for Europe's later success in overseas conquests. For most scholars of international relations, this narrative is no less influential for being tacit, a presumed foundation of why the world is the way it is and how it got that way. As the most consequential, sustained use of armed force and conquest ever in world history, with huge consequences for contemporary international politics, examining and explaining the history of European expansion should be a top priority for social scientists. For a discipline whose whole reason for being is world politics, it is surprising how little international relations research has been conducted on the really big developments. The creation of the first global international system, the relatively brief period of European dominance over the rest of the world in the era of the new imperialism, and the collapse of these world-spanning empires in the 20th century. In part, this might reflect the legacies of the attitude that the proper concern of international relations was restricted to relations between civilized states. Having laid out the main features of the military revolution and how it is said to explain Western global dominance, it is now important to return to three more general topics raised earlier. How we study Europe compared to the rest of the world, the differences and similarities between historians and social scientists' treatment of the military revolution, and the tendency to reason that learning and competition produce well-adapted, functionally efficient, and effective organizations. To anchor the discussion of this last matter, I use an example from African warfare concerning the use of magic in war that sharply illustrates the distinction between the conventional, rational, functionalist logic and a more cultural approach. Eurocentrism. The military revolution thesis was initially about developments in Europe, before being extended to explain why Europeans won and everyone else lost. The common puzzle is what was special about Europe. Why, from unpropitious medieval beginnings, did this region later achieve world domination? Earlier scholars had an unabashed conviction that Europeans were inherently superior to other races. Even though this attitude has been discredited, significant biases linger. To begin with, there is just a lot more history and social science written about Europe, particularly Western Europe, than any other region of the world. Many claims about supposedly unique European achievements have turned out to reflect ignorance about the rest of the world. Any example looks unique if you ignore all the rest. Although this imbalance is far from rectified, new studies of other regions have increasingly debunked claims of European exceptionalism. As one historian puts it, any time someone argues that Europe had an advantage in a given area, say property rights, or per capita income, or labor productivity, or cannon manufacture, along comes an Asian historian pointing out that the claim is false. The case for European exceptionalism has unraveled like a ball of string. Despite their ambitions to come up with general theories of politics, unbound by particular time and place, international relations scholars have often been just as bad in their myopic focus on Europe and their corresponding indifference to the experiences of other parts of the world. One of the main aims of this book is to do something to help rebalance the scales by giving other regions and civilizations equal weight. More than just a matter of being politically incorrect, Eurocentrism has greatly restricted our ability to explain the past and the present. First, as the quote illustrates, proving that there is something truly unique about Europe requires careful, detailed studies of other areas as well. For example, was military competition in Europe really so different from that elsewhere? Second, something of a contrast with seeing Europe as sui generis is the view of Europe as the universal model, defining the normal and natural pattern for others to follow, even if these others were backward in doing so at a later historical stage. Third, there is a tendency to see events that happened in a certain order in Europe as causing each other, and as necessarily having to happen in that specific sequence. The military revolution thesis provides some good examples here. It is not just that new technology and tactics spread, and then by coincidence, shortly afterward...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.